once a year I'll have this idea for a sword that has all the like rainbow pride flag colors on it, and I'd be like, oh yeah, I mean, you could do the yellow color out of the brass and the green out of the verdigris, and I'm like, I get excited for this idea, and I'm like, when's Pride Month? When can I do the sword? And then somebody will say, that was last month. That's probably what put the idea in your head, is you were seeing all these like rainbow flags last month. God damn it! Oh, and then I'll forget about it till next year, but not this year. I remembered that it was June. So that's what we're doing in this video. It'll be auctioned off for charity at the end. Hopefully an entertaining video. So for the blade, I'm going to be using this half inch hardened plate offcut from doing the He-Man sword, who is arguably already a gay icon. It needs to be cleaned up a little bit. There's a thing here I want to take off. This curve isn't perfect because this is the offcut, remember? And the back of this thing needs to be 90'd. So I've got to do that first. So whatever way I cut out the He-Man template, there's this gouge across here that I don't like. So we're going to go whoop across here. Okay, and now to even that out more. Oh, a leg of this tripod is collapsing. Okay, whew. That curve seems even. I might rub it with the sander. And then this guy, the same thing at the back. There's a curve here that doesn't look quite right. Curve, swoop, properly. It still looks like it could come in more. So this guy comes in here. It bulges out in a weird way that is not aesthetic. So just take out that white part. Actually, if I did this with the little sander, I'd have much more control. Gosh, let's take off my breather. The air in here is not so great. That side looks fine, but that side could do with a little more. Broken disc. Not disc. Belt. I'm too used to using angle grinders. Okay, there's a weird thing here, but it's at the edge. And I'm worried that to take that down, you'd have to lose some of the curve, and I'm going to be sharpening this edge anyway. So I only really needed the center of this guy to be flat, flat, flat. So the back of this guy is sloped. I'm pretty sure this was done with a plasma cutter. This is the back of the blade, so that doesn't matter so much for the temper and stuff. But I want to bring it down 90. And so I think I'm just going to take a couple of notches out of it with this guy, and then do most of it with the grinder, but then have these marks as a guide to how far I have to go. Locally, it's weird making this sword as straight as possible. So, yep, I'm calling that flat. It didn't have, sometimes when you have an old rusty piece that's hanging around, you start to sand it back and something nasty will surprise you. But there wasn't anything too bad on this one. Hot. Too hot.
Okay, now to work out the next bit.
I think I'm going to cut off this. I want to put a guard on the back of it. Like this, just a simple guard, because like I said, we're running against the clock here. So just quarter inch plate. I want to cut off that part, make the guard curved up a little bit like this. I think I might use the plasma cutter on this. The handle is probably going to be back here, so I do have to get that part.
It's too hot.
So there's some heavy marks here from the beating it into position, and I just want to double check that the actual place where I'm welding it will be sufficient to cover them up, because I'd have to take out a large amount of material to get rid of that, and I'd just be worried that it would start to interfere with the shape of it. Dang it. This one at the back would have to come out, so hopefully it doesn't start to make the shape weird. And here at the front, I think that one we might get away with, but this one... yeah. Don't think it's too bad. Now let's see, does this, that one over there, straight, does that have to go? Oh, I think that one will have to go as well. Okay, I think that's still good. Yeah. That was a sandpaper drum, which is fine but tends to be kind of rough. And then this was a Scotch-Brite and sandpaper wheel, which I find, this was only a 40 grit one, so quite rough. But I feel, what's that shadow I'm seeing there? But yeah, the worry is they don't leave as smooth of a surface. Like just leave a thing with all sorts of weird little divots. But I think this is going to be okay. Two pins, various holes. This one all the way out here is an inch. I usually do 200% of the width as a depth for the bevel for when I'm sharpening. The shapes where I want to put the colors on the back of the Pride sword. I decided to just cut out a thing on the cameo silhouette thingy bob. Because, oh, did I never put a piece of tape across the top? Oh geez, hopefully this works out. I meant to put a piece of tape across the top of it like there's one on the bottom. I had to do it in two halves because this thing wasn't quite big enough. Come on, there we go. Luckily, these don't, a lot of these get like effects and stuff inside them that they don't have to be completely flat. The actual surface as is only really apparent in these two. So these two have to be ground out a little bit more carefully, but these four can be done relatively quickly because they get stuff then added on top.
I thought about doing separate little inlay plates, but I don't think we have enough time.
There's 2 points right at the end as I was doing these last two, probably because I was getting tired, where the thing skittered out of the thing and it was on the same position in both of them. This one's real bad. So the whole reason of using this guy on the edge was so that it was nice and deep, and if I sand it back, it wouldn't start to change the shape, like if it was like tapered sloped edges. Let's see how you'd repair this. These things actually make it harder to keep the disc pure flat now, so hopefully it's not going to be too crazy. That was the 120, and the actual sanding belt I'm using is like 60 or something, so it should be able to take these grinder marks off. Whoa. Why is everything so hard? Ah! That put more marks in it than I'm going to have to take out again. There we go. That's that big skittery thing out of there. And because of the depth of this thing, the outline of these guys didn't change. So now to do side number two. Yeah, all back and wrists are starting to complain. Hey? Hello, Gideon.
Do you want some candy?
Do I want some candy? I wouldn't say no to some candy.
Come over here then.
Okay. I think I need a smaller file for this bit. I'm going to take off anything nasty on the edges. So on the little sketch I did for the pride sword, just to add some sort of, I don't know, flair to the hand, bottom of the handle, the pommel, I put one of these hooky guys on it. So we need to bend this guy 90 degrees, so that involves firing up the forge again. Oh wow, if this is to scale, I guess it doesn't hurt for the handle to be longer. This is an inch wide, so it just means this handle is shorter than what was... It doesn't matter. The handle will be longer compared to the drawing. Thank you. Ah, it's so hot and sweaty in the air, but I've set up this sandblasting tent with the tarps so that I can shoot the guard piece at point blank range. Where did I put it?
Oh, I'm about to get angry. I blew it off with the air, I dry it. What did I do with it?
I finally found it. It was on the dirt just down there, like within a 3 feet of the camera. But the inside of my workshop's all tidy now because I tidied it looking for this guy. I think I might like spruce it up a little bit before I sandblast it, in case I can get away with just sandblasting it now. There's just a couple of little things on it I don't like. You know, a couple of little marks and things. So we'll see, can I get rid of those? Can't reach these guys. I'll have to get something else. But I'm hoping that the sandblasting will mute that all out and then steel polish back. It's just a different look finish. This is like very scattered, you know. It's a not particularly appealing finish.
So hot.
Okay, I think that's the whole thing done. It's very hot in here. I decided to cold blue the handle just because those lines in between the diamonds are going to be an absolute nightmare to clean, and so they might look a bit neater and tidier if they're black. You know, the black, if done correctly, also stops it from rusting, but if I leave this juice on too long, it'll make it rust. I need to rinse this off with water now and steel wire brush it and see what happens. In focus, I don't know how obvious it is. Probably not super obvious, but yeah, in the low light, the contrast between the diamonds and the grooves between them is obviously higher now. But I gotta clean up all the sides. Did I mention this is the first pineapple twist I did ever? So by owning the sword, you're also owning my first attempt at one of these guys. This is a heat gun set up with a extendo arm for cameras. What I'm doing here is, normally when I'm trying to get steel to turn a specific color using heat, I use the torch. But I find the torch is, the temperature difference between blue and purple is so slight that I wanted something that could like heat up the steel super slow and then have more control over it that way. And the heat gun, sure enough, does that. Also, I was worried about overheating stuff. These things are probably some of the last steps I'll do, because of how delicate these things are would be compared to the other bits. But before I proceeded, I want to see, was it even possible? And I think it will be. It's slow, which is annoying, but it's way better for it to be slow and actually work. What does that look like? It's now purple. And this isn't the finish. This is just the rough. I can't touch any of this, it's too hot. But this is just the rough thing as well. But you can see how it localized the purple just to that one spot. So I'm not super worried about it downranging the temper of the edge. I kind of feel like keeping going just for the laugh and then sending it back just to show you guys what it looks like. So the light's not super grey here, but I mean, that's purple. Now, I did do an additional experiment on the other side that didn't work, where it was purple and then I damaged it and tried to make it purple again, and I don't think it worked. So the only bad thing about this oxide thing is, I think once you get them up to color, if you have to repair them, I think you have to completely clean out the area. Where's the sanding pad? I took the sanding pad and I scoured it a bit. And then I tried to get it back up to color and there was no dice. It wouldn't go for me. So maybe some oil or residue came off this or something. But it has to be super, super clean, it turns out, for this here to work. So now these two and this one here have to be brazed. This one with silicon bronze, these two just regular brass. So let's have a quick exploratory see, can we do that without getting this edge blue? I'm at the wrong height, I need a chair. But still, the heat doesn't, ow. Oh, some blue is creeping in here. But I thought this thing would die way sooner. This is why I want to do this and this at the very end afterwards. Did that spread to the edge? Not really. I guess, so I'm just gonna keep going. I might check in with the silicon bronze one because that one will be weird and awkward compared to these two. Now, when I did stuff similar to this on the Gotrek axe, I wound up having to TIG braze in the silicon bronze and then just melt it out with the torch. That worked much better. But I'm kind of hopeful. So let's see, is it just possible to braze this? The silicon bronze is much more cantankerous than the brass. It worked, but it took much more heat. See, I made all this part blue, which means the temper of this thing is now damaged. Normally I'd freak out about that, but ever since I made the trident, like that was a very skinny shape that was brazed all the way out to the edge, and that survived the like beating it around the place. So I'm not super worried about it, but still it's a shame. So last night, after braising the things, I put this guy in the vinegar. Oh wow, look, the vinegar's... this is actively bubbling. See the bubbles? But I put it in this stuff because I find the vinegar, it helps dissolve the flux and sometimes brings back the shininess of this thing. Here, if I rub this, what does that look like? See the way that's shiny copper in under there? This black layer seems to be only very superficial. Let's get those out of there and wash them. See, is there any remains of flux on the surface to take off? I hope not. Like a little tiny bit of flux. Oh, and there's a brass piece there that didn't get done. This is the exact type of reason I like leaving it soaked in the vinegar. See, there's a, I don't know, can you see it? Probably not, it's very hard, but there's a silver piece here where the brass, ah! But you can see I completely got that with the silicon bronze, because that's the one that was difficult, so I was worried about it. So I guess I'll just get that one little spot. So annoying! There we go. See the silver spot in the middle? It's like right in the middle of the frame now. I don't know how that happened. So annoying. This is some sandpaper just wrapped around the top of a thing so I can do this. Rounded edge. This is a strip from a 21 by 3 belt that had a torn edge and was otherwise useless. This is a block of wood to tighten the bow. I don't know, can you see on the surface? It's hard to see when everything's shiny, but a lot of the brass has been up onto the surface because it's so soft. And so, did any of the copper get transferred? The silicon bronze? It's slightly harder, so I don't think it did. So, now I can sand the surface. I gotta stop to eat now. But when I come out later, I think I'm gonna leave these last two till the very end, but these four I want to try and cutter now. These three is basically the ring out your great. No, these three are basically Bell in Victory. Oh, that was because Isaac Newton or whoever it was. That was because the guy who was deciding on the spectrum insisted on indigo and violet being separate colors because seven is a magic number. Indigo, violet. These one, two, three. It's basically the same thing of like heating them up and putting on chemicals to make them go funny. So I can do that tonight. So two things. One, in order for to do this silicon bronze, in order to make it turn the bright red, it has to get heated up a lot and then quenched in a mixture of borax and water. I said hopefully, because I've done it before, but like kind of accidentally and stuff, and I don't remember ever doing this exact process where like I looked it up on the internet to remind myself how it is you do it, and I was like, really? I don't quite remember doing it that way before, but I don't remember how it was I did it before. But yeah, we're going to heat this up and then quench it in borax and water. Why did I take my goggles off? I should have left my goggles on. That is not red at all. That's just black. So that was a lie. So an experiment I probably should have tried before I started is this is just a piece of copper I have here. I want to see, does that borax, quench it while it's hot and borax thing even work on copper? Turned red, but I think we can do better for this guy. I think the borax is weird, it's sticky and it's a salt. Salt's gonna leave this thing rusty. I just need this thing to cool down enough that I can clean the borax off. This cleaned up just perfectly, so at least that the borax thing didn't damage it, and this guy's yellow now. But now I have to figure out how to make this guy turn red. I have a couple ideas. This is ferric chloride. If memory serves, I think I used it before. So we're going to attempt this. This is nasty stuff, like horrible poison. So we're going to see what it does when I... What's up with this paintbrush? Oh wow, it makes the steel turn red. Oh no, I forgot to clean the back of this. Disaster. So I think we leave that on there for a little while. I think I did something like this on that Blade Ascension, and I can't remember what I learned the secret was. Was the secret to keep it wet? Was the secret to only put on a tiny bit and let it evaporate on the surface? I can't remember what the secret was. The answer was directly in front of the heater in a thin layer that is so thin it evaporates, and maybe doing it twice, like doing it twice for good measure, but a thin layer that evaporates is the key. This one is the simpler one. It's not hard to make steel rusty. Usually you're trying to do the other go in the other direction. So this is, I shouldn't hover this over the sword. This is hydrogen peroxide and vinegar. The hydrogen peroxide provides the oxygen for the reaction.
It just makes it faster. You can instantly see that making the sword, this thing rusty. And brand new rust is this bright, vibrant orange. Oh wow, look at it go. And so my hope is by sealing it with the Ren wax afterwards, we can seal it at the point where it was this lovely bright orange color. This one here, this one gets just salt water and vinegar. I wonder what the hydrogen peroxide speeded up. This is practically the same mix. Oh, something's happening real quick. But I think this one you have to leave it overnight to get results. Weird, that's a very different reaction. I wonder what this, what the hydrogen peroxide and vinegar do for this guy too. In order to just make it clean, it'd be wild if the same solution worked on all of them. So I'm going to seal these up. I'm a little bit nary because the thing I wanted to seal them up with, because it was the right size, is aluminum tape, which would also dissolve with this stuff, with the salt and the vinegar and whatnot. But I might leave it like propped upside down or like on its spine, so that if the aluminum tape fails, that it fails and then melts through and falls this way. If I turn this upside down, does juice fall out? No. So we're gonna leave this like this here, and then come back tomorrow and see what happened. So none of these worked particularly well. It's funny that it made these two basically the same color. So we're kind of back to the drawing board. That's okay. This was the one I was most shocked about. Like, this one had an orange layer on it, and then when I rubbed it with my finger, it just comes off. Like, it's not rusty at all. So, very strange. You know, so after washing it off with water, this one looks more red than it had done to me. And this one is obviously, it's like these two are basically still the same color, but like, that orange layer is gone. I'm very disappointed that this one didn't rust at all, but I seem to remember now, with doing ascension and with rusting other things, that leaving it soaking overnight is not actually the answer. It's thin layers and then letting it evaporate, like leaving it in vinegar overnight. Like, you, when I pull something out of the vinegar bath, I have to dry it immediately, really quick, because it'll start to flash rust. And the flash rust is actually what I'm looking for. So I think I'm going to try it again, but instead of leaving it overnight, I'm going to try painting things onto these and then blow drying them and then seeing, does that work any better? Oh wow, is this making it turn green? Ah, I should use this technique on this one over this way. This is just hydrogen peroxide and vinegar. Ah, we're getting there now. So while I work on trying to get these guys to the colors I want, I've decided to start sharpening it, because this will ambiently heat up the blade, and it's kind of more that gentle heat that hopefully will agitate these reactions into going quicker, but also time. I'm in a bit of a time squeeze, so it just makes sense to start working on the next thing. This part looked like it was flared out, even though I was following the line, and no, this is all brought down to the quarter inch. This is just two quarter inch plates welded together. Yeah, it's a weird trick of the light. If you look down it looks like this part goes broop. There's something that feels weird here. I hope it resolves itself. So I did the mop disc with the 9-inch grinder, and then went 25 grit with the small one, which is even more than which is a harsher grit than that thing, but just to remove than the big grinder, but just to remove more material. Something also feels weird here. The reason I'm getting weird about stuff feeling weird is this is 120 grit disc, so it can't really remove much material. Ideally, the 60 grit one is the last
removing material one, and then this guy is just for polishing. But, and it's hard to polish if there's still all lumpy bumpy weirdnesses. Okay, cool. I'm kind of freaking out now because I'm running out of time, and none of these are the colors I need them to be. This is way too dark. This is way too, this looks, just doesn't look anything like the red I need it to. And this thing is not even remotely approaching the green. But look at this. These were the samples I left out. Both of these were covered in different types of chemicals. Look at that green. And this thing here, this bar, I can't even remember which chemicals were on which part of it. Which is, I often say, you know, like when I do nerd roleplay game type stuff, that the difference between science and mad science is replicatability. Like that if your character just has a bit of a moment during a roleplay game and like does a bunch of mad science, they can get better results. But they will never get those results again. And that's usually where I draw the line between the two for game purposes. But I find that it's true in real life too. So the difference between these... Oh my god, look at how green this one is! So the difference between these pieces and this sword is this sword spent the night indoors while those guys were just sitting there on this bench. So... Oh, it's so annoying. It's like the answer might be to just put the stuff on it and then leave the sword out overnight. Like in the wet and see what happens. It's Friday. I have till Monday to finish the sword. Like this was supposed to be a nice simple job. Look at it, it's such a mess. So I think I'm going to clean it up again. And what we're going to do is, look at all those lovely oranges. Except for that one. I think that was the naval jelly. I can't quite remember. And then these guys, I don't even know what they were, but look how green they are. If I could just get some color like that to appear on this guy. Yeah, I think I'm leaving the sword outside tonight and hoping for a miracle. I hope the corrosion fairies visit it in the night. So I want to TIG weld this guy. The TIG welder is interfered with by these magnets, or magnets in general. And so I want to get a tack on it here with the MIG welder, which is a little bit messier. And the MIG welder is hardly affected by anything, but the MIG welder is much messier. So I have to put this on to stop getting spattered everywhere. And I hope this stuff doesn't interfere with the TIG welder. TIG welder is a very delicate creature. Jeez, maybe this one is also affected by the magnetic field. That was making a very strange noise. Now I should be able to remove these. Oh, that's wild. These were locked onto the thing in opposite ways. I wonder did that affect it even more. But yeah, now I can fooster with it and make little adjustments till I get it right. Because I tacked it on this side instead of in the middle, because the arc was acting all weird, it pulled this way. So I'm hoping I can gently go tap, tap, tap and get it back in position. You can see that bevel. Like, you can see through to the other side in some spots, and that's what I'm going to fill up weld. And then it's going to be extremely difficult to convince this guy to come off this guy.
without the use of aggressive power tools. So, a little bit of camera trickery. I left the camera in the workshop last night, so I kind of ducked back and got it so I could film myself walking up to the workshop. It's a dull day, but it's like feels hot and kind of steamy. And the sword is clamped. See, it's behind in the jaw horse behind there. I didn't look at it as I was grabbing the camera. And I'm kind of freaking out that when I look at it, ooh! Honestly, I was expecting the sword itself. Oh, there's some rust here. This spent the night outdoors. So I was expecting the sword. It's weird that, is it because it's smooth? Is it because this had texture? Is that why this part is still, I didn't finish cleaning up the guard. I was too tired and exhausted. But the important part, look at all those colors! I mean, you can't really tell the yellow one is yellow because of the angle I'm at. Did it work on both sides? Oh, you can see some of the rust bled over. Why was that so hard? Oh, and there's a little tiny bit of where the silver is, the gold is poking, still poking through on this one. Oh, the hot, steamy night outside where, oh, and there's a piece of something on the back of that one. Weird. Like there's a spot of, like just one spot of green on the back of the rusty thing. Rusty one. Green? So weird. Like it was hanging upside down, so I guess all the juice would have gathered at this one spot. But I don't know why it's green. Yeah, the difference was just like spending a hot, steamy night outside, like having the sword. I don't even want to touch this because on the other sampity bits, like this guy, it's very fragile and powdery. So I have to figure out how to get some sort of sealer on there before I touch it. That's a different green. This is the brass, which that nominally is, but it's brass from a brazing rod. I don't know, is the makeup different? Oh wow, having spent a second night outside, the green on this part is all messed up. It's like not green anymore. Whereas this spot of green, oh wow. That's not fragile anymore. That's gone hard. But see, that's a different green to that green. Even though these are both brass, this is copper. And the green on there looks more akin to the copper green. Oh, that was so hard. That was stressing me out a lot. Oh, I left these out last night because I thought it was funny. With all of the chemicals, you see there's some jars. See these jars? That one is hydrogen peroxide, vinegar, and borax, and salt. And that one, this one is the mystery jar that You would have thought that the green one would have caused the green, but it's actually this one that caused the green, and I don't know. I think I already had a rant about the difference between science and mad science is replicatability. I'm not actually sure what's in this jar anymore. It's ferric chloride and borax and little bits of copper flakes that I ground up. And this hydrogen peroxide and the vinegar, and the hydrogen peroxide has to be dead by now, so I don't even know would that have any effect. But I made the mistake of leaving these paintbrushes in those jars, and see the ferrules on them are just worn away to nothing. Like the steel things for holding the brush heads on are just gone now, because I foolishly left them in there. Now I have two sticks that I can use for some purpose. Oh, there's some other spill of something interesting.
There's a lot of corrosive stuff just kind of lying around now with this project. Like, look at that. It's bright atomic orange. I think that was one of the hydrogen peroxide and vinegar mixes for trying to do the rust. Now to just figure out what to spray on it to seal it. I was going to use the Ren Wax, and I might yet use the Ren Wax, but I'm worried about... Because normally with the Ren Wax, you rub it on. And I don't want to rub this stuff at all, because it's too powdery. I'm going to have to find some other way to apply it. Maybe drip it on with a candle. But before I apply the Ren Wax, I need to do these two parts. I might have a little episode if applying the heat to this to make this turn blue. The heat from it might affect this. Hopefully not. I guess we'll find out. Will I clean up the guard first or do these? I think I'll clean up the guard first. Try to be very careful. I hit the green here by mistake. I don't know, can you see? I actually hit it one bit in the middle and it looked pretty dumb. So I kind of gently rubbed it with my finger and that's all it did take it off. So that's very concerning. I'm gonna have to get some sort of sealer on there. But like I said, I don't want to put the sealer on till I've welded the handle on. So annoying. I have to leave it though because I can feel part of me being tempted to add a little bit more of that weird mixture, but if I add the mixture, there's no telling what might happen. It might dissolve everything around it. That area might go come back, but like weirder and splotchier. Like it is weird and splotchy already, but it like might, actually there's some dust in there. But I'm worried that it will, I'm worried that if I mess with it in any way, I'll just make it worse. So I have to live with that. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue. This is the purple one. I think when I was doing the sample, I did this one as purple. But, okay, so have those cleaned out now. Gonna do the blue one first. And hopefully it doesn't interfere with this guy. If it does, I might cry. So there's nothing like switching up the variables at the last minute. So I'm using a number 2 tip. Because I have a theory that if I can apply the heat more slowly, I can get more control. I might be wrong about that, but let's see. I'm so nervous. Like I said, this is the one where it tends to shoot straight past that purple color that I need for the next slot. Oh, there's the blue. And much like all the chemicals and how I noticed that very thin layers and then exposure to air tended to cause the color change. I've noticed that with the trying to get the blue color on this guy, that like if you lift up the torch, whoop, and then lift up, that's when you get the color change. Not actually when the torch is on it. This guy over here hasn't reacted yet, so that's good. That's blue. Gently flip it over. Oh, there's a lighter just waiting to pop. Okay, did doing this side affect the other side? A little bit, but I think it's still blue. Okay, and now the purple. We're so close, so close. So here we are with the rig set up for doing the final color, the purple. Unlike a lot of the things I do, I have video evidence that this worked at least once. That's it, now it's just a waiting game. I'm gonna tidy up tools and stuff while that does its thing. Oh my god, this is so slow! I moved the whole rig inside because it was taking so long. It's so slow, but that's what I wanted because if you look at the temper chart, the yellows take up quite a band, and the blues take up a very big band, but the purple is just one little tiny sliver at around 540, and that's why we have to do it this way, the slowest way in the universe. And I'm so bored and I'm so hungry and it's dark outside now and there are wolves. On the original drawing I did, I had the handle all the way back here, like the back of the handle lined up with the back of the spine.
But looking at this guy, it just doesn't seem quite right. So I think it should be moved in more. I traced this guy out based on measurements. And then we take the handle. Just as a sanity check. So let's say we put this here. Ish. And then we had a look at it from the side and we're like, yeah, that's about what I was thinking. Okay, now some of the complicated clamping. The shape of this guy means it's going to be an absolute nightmare to clamp down properly.
I missed the start of me welding this, but basically it's the same idea as before, welding into these big holes, whoop, trying to get at the very heart of the thing. I haven't done this side yet. But this is, we're just left with the surface weld now.
The heat pad caught fire. Never a good sign.
That's the last of the welding done. That's it done. The handle is on. The orange got darker when I sprayed it with the WD-40, the oil. I might use acetone to strip out the oils and stuff. And then rehydrogen peroxide. Just that one part. But that's kind of tricky and finicky. It does read as orange, but it's a dark orange. Okay, I'm gonna go to bed now.
Did I wash all of the acid off this brush? Who knows? Thank you. So I was worried about the sword holding up, but as you can see, or maybe we can't from all the way over there, there's only damage, well, not damage, there's like little scrapes and stuff along here because that's where I was hitting. None of the actual colors took damage, which is what I was really worried about. I was worried like a random stick or lump of something was going to go blip and hurt the verdigris, but it seems to have survived just fine. When I make a small thing like this, it gets auctioned off for charity. We're going to be a little bit different this month. The charity organization is Hope Church in Bloomington, Illinois. They made the mistake of thinking that Jesus' love was for everyone. And a bunch of like homophobic people said, no, you are incorrect. So I don't pretend to understand God or being gay, but only one side is sending death threats to a 22-year-old. So I'm pretty sure I know how I feel in this situation. So if you would like to place a bid on this sword, there'll be details in the video description. The auction will run about a month. I have to clean up the sword now.
I tested it earlier and it said 70 megabits per second, but it's not behaving like 70 megabits per second.
No.
My dad, being a bit like me, he gets his internet from a neighbor. And if I go sit at the wall that's closest to the neighbor's house, and now... Is it any better? Is it less choppy?
Yeah. I think we wanted to tell Mike why Hope is a good recipient of a Pride donation, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Oh my gosh. Sunday we shared what is happening with Hope Church. People gasped, then applauded. Congregation so filled with people who don't fit in, many of whom don't fit in anywhere else, who have been told that they're not worthy, that they are going to hell, that they're not children of God. And we have a space that says that absolutely everyone's loved. And your sword like has brought this intersection of, and there is someone like Mike who believes in us. Isaac, do you want to share like what's been happening with our church?
No, I was just going to add that like I like to say that we're like the weirdest, most eclectic church you'll ever meet. It's incredible. We have like as many drag queens as we do people who wear slacks every day. We have more Dungeons and Dragons groups than we do like Bible study groups. And it's just like, however folks feel connected to one another, that's what we do.
I don't know what prompted you to direct this generosity our way, but we're in the midst of receiving a lot of hate mail telling us how awful we are.
I think people are afraid of the boundaries of what faith can be. And we, as like a queer church that celebrates drag artists in the pulpit and at every level, saying that if a drag queen can be in a pulpit, then anyone can be. and like, I think whenever boundaries of society are challenged, people get afraid. That fear turns into anger very quickly when it's not coped with in healthy mechanisms. So I think that's why the white nationalists are targeting us.
I'm so sorry. Yeah.
Bless you, Jenny.
I was trying to.
Way to ruin my mojo.
Mike, what made you want to make a big gay sword? Because you were making a big gay sword before you knew you were making it, before you decided you made it for us. What made you decide to make a big gay sword in the first place?
Well, okay, so you might be surprised, but when it comes to like making like giant city weapons, there's a lot of toxic masculinity flying around. And like, I just wanted like at every point where I could signal, no, like take a step back, you know, just to signal like in whatever way I can, the kind of, in the same way you guys are signaling what it means to be religious, I would like to signal what it means to be like a manly man messing with like power tools. It's like, you can do that without being an asshole, maybe. Like there doesn't have to be a link between all this toxic nonsense and making swords, you know?
Yeah. That is exactly what we're doing.
Yeah.
There does not have to be a link between all this toxic nonsense and faith.
Yeah.
Mm.
That is the short answer. The concise reason we're getting hate is because we're a church bold enough to say that God loves absolutely everyone, and we've included in that LGBTQ2S+ people, and we have a church that celebrates the artistry of drag, i.e. drag queens and kings, and have included drag artists like Isaac in the preaching and teaching at our congregation. And Isaac, who are you in drag?
Miss Pentecost. Yes.